أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين شفيع المذنبين حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد محمد وآل محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يوم عداوتهم إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولا تتمنوا ما فضل الله به بعضكم على بعض آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلي على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته I begin in the name of Allah, the most kind, the most merciful. It's due to that kindness and mercy that we have these opportunities where we gather in remembrance and glorification of Him, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. I pray that each and every one of you are well and healthy, inshallah, and that you are enjoying the good weather that we have started to experience, inshallah. The discussion that we are going to have tonight is around the verse that we mentioned from Surah An-Nisa, verse number 33. That we will talk about in a second, but it deals with the overall subject of the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the subject of adalat. As we know, the subject of adalat is one of the cornerstones of our belief structure, and it is that cornerstone that allows us to know that everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does is with the interest of mankind to be successful, that God never wants to see us fail. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to see His creation going to Jahannam. I think this is a really obvious intellectual deduction that why would someone create someone to perish? You want them to be successful, and so you give them every opportunity to be successful. And at the end of the day, if they decide to follow the guidance, they would be successful. If they don't, then they won't. And there's no one to blame but the individual themselves. The concept of justice is really important for us to understand because it answers many of the questions that sometimes comes into our minds, right? That why are there so much injustices in the world that we live in? Why is there oppression in this world that we live in? And so when we understand the concept of justice, it helps us answer these questions. And it's something that's necessary to study. It's necessary for us to understand, and it can't be accomplished in a 35-minute lecture, but it's something that needs to be addressed. We're going to be looking at a segment of the topic of adalat, right? But to do so, we need to first define what do we mean by justice. When we say that God is adil, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just, what does that mean? So sometimes the definition of justice that is provided is that of equality, or impartiality, right? So that when you can treat people equally, fairly, impartially, oftentimes society will think that we have been just in the way that we have treated people. This definition works in certain instances in our relationships and in our encounters with mankind. So for example, when we talk about people with from different backgrounds, from different races, from different nationalities, we say to treat everyone the same way, fairly, right? We treat them with the same due respect. It doesn't matter if you are East African, Pakistani, Iraqi, we treat everyone fairly, and that's the expectation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for us. But even in human interaction, this type of equal treatment does not produce the right results because there are people who may have varying needs, hence they may need a little bit more of a leg up for them to be successful. And so rather than equality, we strive for equity sometimes, right? Like you may have seen this, they show this, it's a really good picture of like in the school boards, they show it about the importance of equity. And so you have a fence, for example, right? And you have these kids who are looking at a baseball game. And so you have one kid who is taller, one kid who is maybe medium height, and one kid who is shortened, right? So you picture this scenario, and they're all looking at a baseball field. And they say that for them to be able to watch successfully, let's give everyone one box to stand on. Now, naturally, the one who is taller will be really tall and be able to see. The one in the middle may be the right height, but the one who is short is still too short. But they say this is what equality looks like, where you give everyone one box to stand on. But really what we need is equity. The guy who's tall doesn't even need a box, so we don't give them any boxes. The one in the middle needs one box, but the shorter one needs two boxes. And so you divide your resources correctly, hence you are being equitable in the way you treat people. There is no doubt that the world that we live in today, there are segments of our society who have suffered tremendously during the course of history. Hence, today, you can't just tell them, well, that happened 250 years ago, snap out of it. No, there's baggage that carries forward, right? In particular, when you think about the black community and the level of difficulties and hardships that they have had to endure, oftentimes people will say, well, slavery ended a long time ago. Catch up. It's not so simple, right? We know, if you study anything about history, you know that slavery just transformed itself into another form of slavery through the prison system, through poverty, through all of these different things that have taken place. And so you can't just have laws that are equal thinking that everyone will be successful. All it does, it adds more hardships in the long run. And so when you think about that form of equality, that's not the correct form of justice even for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He were to say, I'm going to treat everyone equally, that means He would have to disregard the fact that there are people who don't have the same opportunities that you and I have, for example. Someone living in abject poverty does not have the luxury of comfortably driving to their mosque, sitting in an air-conditioned mosque, now today without our masks here, yeah? I saw all of you rip it off, I'm paying attention, you know? But this is a luxury that we have. Now, if Allah expects us to work a certain way and someone who has to navigate through checkpoints and fear of death and fear of poverty and sitting in a humid environment, and Allah says, both of you got to figure it out, I'm judging you the same, we would say God is being unjust in that particular situation. Yeah. And so equality is not the same as justice, right? Even as a madrasa teacher or any teacher, we recognize that there are certain students who may need a little bit more time, who may need a little bit more effort because their home life may be maybe more difficult than somebody who has the advantages that they do. And so equality and impartiality never really equates to justice. And so when we talk about justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is actually a different definition of justice that we are seeking. And scholars have provided a beautiful explanation, but I'm just going to paraphrase, for example, what Ayatollah Nasser Makarem Shirazi says about justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way we understand what it means that when we say that God is just, we are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives each individual exactly what they need to be successful without depriving them or oppressing them of what they need. You understand? This is important, okay? That when we say that God is just, what we are truly saying is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives every individual exactly what they need to be successful and never oppressing them by depriving them of what they need. Now, what each individual needs is different, right? Even us coming from the same background, living in the same geography, we all need different things because we are created differently. Our mechanisms are differently, right? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides each individual with exactly what they need to be successful. Now, you know, I like to like give an example of like cups, right? So you have cups that are of different sizes. You have a small cup, a medium cup, a big cup, like a Tim Hortons, right? You have a small, medium, large, extra large, different size cups. Depending on one's capacity, I may have a small cup. You may have a medium cup. You may have a large cup. But what we do know that the justice of God is such that He will give us enough liquid, in this example, to fill our cups. If, for example, He knows I have a small cup and He knows you have a medium cup, but then He only gives us enough to fill small cups, the one with the medium cup can say, "You are unjust to me. You didn't give me enough." But He gives each individual exactly what they need to be successful. Now, whether that individual uses that cup correctly, that's up to that individual. That's where free will comes in, right? But the fact is that God would never deprive an individual of what they need to be successful. This is what we mean by the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that no matter what our situation or circumstance, He will give us with what we need to be successful. Yeah. Now, if we understand that that is the definition of justice, then how do we prove that God is just, right? Now, generally, there are two ways to prove something. There's what's known as naqli and there's aqli. Naqli is what comes from written text, for example, right? Now, the simplest way, and for me, the most beautiful way to prove that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just is because God says so, yeah? I tell you, that answer is the most satisfactory answer. I've shared this with you. You know, when I was young, and not as much as the youngsters of today's generation, because everything today can be Googled, can be figured out, and can be described. But when we were young, we wanted to know why. Yeah, why? And then, you know, there came a certain time where maybe some white hair started to come, and the answer, because God said so, and that's so satisfactory. It's so satisfactory, yeah, because God said so. But, you know, we try that with our children, don't we? Why can't I? Because I said so. We say it all tough, and sometimes some of our kids will accept it, some will laugh at us. Yeah, it'll be like, what? What do you mean you said so? Tell me why, right? But there comes a certain time when we focus on the right priorities, and the right priorities being proving the existence of God. Once we have proven the existence of God and are comfortable that there is an entity that is divine, that is powerful, that is God, then whatever that God says, I need to accept it because I've accepted that He's God. You understand or no? Yeah, get that. If you can get that, life becomes so much more beautiful because God said so. Alhamdulillah, I'm good with that, right? But God says so. God says in the Quran in numerous places that God is just. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, in surah number 10, verse number 44 says, "Inna Allaha la yadhlimu an-nasa shay'a," that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not oppress anyone anyway. Yeah, even the slightest bit. God says, "I do not oppress." Walakinna an-nasa anfusahum yadhlimun, but mankind themselves oppress each other. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa, verse number 40, "Inna Allaha la yadhlimu mithqala dharra," that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not oppress even the atom's weight of anything. That Allah does not oppress anyone. And so that understanding tells us that God is just, right? Now, how do we intellectually prove it? Because the beauty about our theology, our understanding and the belief structure is that everything can be intellectually proven, not the jurisprudential aspect, right? Again, this is where we fall into a trap, right? We want to know why 3 rakat, why 4 rakat. We want to know why can't I do like this and why do I have to do this? These are the wrong questions. The right question is about God. Is there a God? Why can't there be 2 gods? And if we can establish that, then all of the jurisprudential aspect is submission. We submit to it because we've accepted that this is God, right? And so this idea of proving the justice of God can be done intellectually, right? And how do we do that? And so one of the things that we described justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we said that justice means that He does not oppress anyone, right? He does not deprive you of your of your needs of being successful. Now, these needs are not material. These needs are spiritual, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deprive one of their spiritual needs of being successful. And if we've proven, and if we understand that that's the definition of justice, that God does not oppress, if we want to prove the justice of God, we have to kind of ask ourselves the question that what are the causes of oppression, right? And so today when we see oppression in the world, there are some underlying causes that bring about this oppression. Even in our own individual lives, if within a family, one member of the family oppresses their spouse, right? Or if a parent is oppressive towards their child, or it could be that a child would be oppressive towards their parents. There are underlying causes that bring about this oppression, right? And so what are these underlying causes? And again, that's a small microcosm of the larger society. When we see governments today oppress, there are underlying causes, right? So what are some of these causes? Well, the simplest cause would be ignorance, right? Ignorance is a cause of oppression. What that means is that I don't fully think it through and realize that my actions are having an adverse consequence on somebody else. And hence, ignorantly, I am oppressing someone else, right? So for example, like a very simple example would be like on Juma, you come, you can't find parking, you see Molana's parking empty, you park it, yeah? Molana Rizvi comes, it'd be like, what's going on, yeah? Your ignorance about the fact that this pot belongs to somebody else and you wanted to just do something that makes you quick and easy has oppressed somebody else. And in fact, now Molana's late trying to find parking, everyone's waiting, everyone's oppressed because of the ignorance of one person's actions. If you want to look at it in a different form of example, the different example would be is that maybe a few decades ago, we were not cognizant of the adverse effects that our actions are having on the environment. And so our actions, we would waste, we would purchase unnecessarily, we would throw away, we would be disregarding of our responsibilities and the effects that it's having on the earth. Now we look today is that we're at this breaking point, or we're already at the breaking point, that our actions have had these effects. Now, the reason is we were ignorant of it. But our ignorance caused a series of effects that we oppressed the earth. You understand, right? And so there's a responsibility to that. So one of the causes of oppression is ignorance. Another cause is need, right? Need, which can be translated into greed. So for example, my need to be in power supersedes your needs of whatever they are. And so I will take that power any way that I can get it, right? I am the man. And so my word says and my word goes. And so I act in this way where I oppress the people of my household, for example, right? And so this happens in all areas of life where one's need for something, they are willing to overstep the boundaries of expectation or social norms to achieve those needs. And hence their neediness for something, their greediness for something causes them to act oppressively, right? One's need of power will cause them to oppress their people, right? Another one could be, for example, inability, right? I, for example, may be in a position that I have certain authority, but in that authority, if I see someone being oppressed, I find myself unable to assist them. And so because of my inability of assistance, I am guilty of oppression as well, right? This is why no one should really desire positions of power, because you have a tremendous amount of responsibility that comes from that, right? And so inability is, again, a reason why oppression takes place. Sometimes it's selfishness, right? Like, I have a grudge. I don't like you. So I'm going to oppress you, right? I dislike you, so I'm going to do anything I can to seek revenge against you, right? Or to oppress you. And so these are generally what society or what we see around us. Things like need, inability, ignorance, selfishness. Now, when you look at these reasons, What we find is that all of these reasons are based on certain type of deficiency, okay? Whether it's, for example, deficiency of the intellect, right? So that's when ignorance kicks in. Or it could be deficiency of the physical nature, where one is unable to do something or unable to do something. It could be a form of deficiency having to do with the spiritual nature of someone. They are needy. They are greedy. All of these reasons that we've talked about, these deficiencies, when we look at it from the lens of God, God is not deficient in any way. You understand? God is not unable. God can do whatever he wants. God is not needy. God is the most self-sufficient. God is not greedy. God has everything at his disposal. God is not vengeful in the way that sometimes we become vengeful. God is not ignorant. And so when you look at the reasons of oppression, and then you say that, yes, they apply to me, but they don't apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they don't apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the natural intellectual deduction would be that God has no need to oppress anyone. Hence, by default, God is just. You understand or no? Yeah? It should be tingling the mind. Yeah? Unless you're asleep already. But it should be tingling the mind. Because this is the intellectual deduction or process of deduction is where we reach to the fact that God is just. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. So if we have now defined justice, we have proven justice, then the question that we want to answer today from the verse that I read in the khutbah is come from Surah Nisa, verse number 33. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْا مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْدَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Allah says that do not covet or do not desire the advantages that Allah has given some of you over others. Yeah? وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْا. Do not desire. Yeah? تَمَنَّى. Favor. Covet. Do not covet or desire. مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ. فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ here is referring to the fadl of God, the grace of God, the advantages that God gives بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ, that God gives to some over others. Now, if we have established that God is just, yeah, we have proven that God is just, then isn't giving advantages to one person over the other a form of injustice? If, for example, today I give you 2 samosas and I give you no samosas, isn't that a form of, I'd be like, I favored him, right? And you'd be like, no, that's unjust. And so when you look at the world that we live in, there are some who are healthier. There are some who are stronger. Some who are richer. Some who have more skills when it comes to certain things. Some who are smarter. Some who have a good voice to recite. Yeah. Some have all of these different advantages. And so the question is then, where is the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And why does he say then that he gives certain advantages to certain people over others? This is a really nice verse of the Holy Quran, but that needs an explanation. Because again, I think the problem is sometimes we will read it and we will form an opinion that, okay, God has been doing this for others, but then it leaves a doubt in the mind. We shouldn't have a verse in the Quran that leaves a doubt in the mind, you know? One of the things that I do till today, and I enjoy doing this, is that when I read the Quran, I have a list that I make, right? So my list this year has like 3 columns. Because this year, if you recall, I told you that what I am trying to do, and I'm hoping that some of you are doing it, is that this year, from Shawwal to the next Ramadan, the plan is to read the entire Quran in English, right? Because I think we've done a really good job of reading the Quran in Arabic, but I'm not sure how many of us really know what God has said in this book, right? And so my plan is to read the Quran in English. But then I have a list. So it's there in my desk and I write it. So one list is, look up the tafsir of this verse. Because I read it and I'm like, what is God saying? Because it leaves that tinge of confusion. You're like, wait a minute. Is God saying he favors others? Does God say he likes others more? Does God say everyone's going to heaven? So I have a list of verses that I have to look up the translation. Then I have another list that I said this would make an interesting topic for a lecture, right? This is where one of these comes from. And then the third list is like when I find translations which are problematic. And so I look at the translation, I look at the Arabic, but that's my list, right? But this is something that I think we should all be doing. When we read the Quran, you have a question, park it. You don't have to park it, but park it somewhere where you come back to it, because you can't leave doubts, right? Doubts become problematic long-term, where we eventually we will doubt the whole religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that stemmed from one small seed. And so solve it, right? Read a tafsir, contact a scholar, help them or help understand these things. Now, to answer this question, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He gives certain advantages to some over others, we have to look at these advantages in two ways, okay? One is advantages that are stemming from what's known as societal factors. Societal factors. Other advantages are innate advantages. Innate factors. So we are born with them, okay? When you look at, let's look at the first one. The first one is societal factors. Many of the advantages that we see in our world today, and again, we're talking about very, to a certain extent, materialistic advantages, right? Some are wealthier, some are healthier, some are have better education, some have better access to water, some have all of these things. These are advantages that we have over others. Most of these advantages are because of societal inequalities, right? Inequalities that exist in our world based on our own actions. These are not the handiwork of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? You look at wealth, you look at healthcare, gender inequality, religious persecution, race inequality, social class. We can go on and on and on, right? We just have to look at the news and we see all of these different forms of injustices that are taking place. In these examples, right, the inequalities and injustices that we see have nothing to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are man-made, right? Someone along the line has unjustly accumulated too much wealth, which has then deprived that wealth to trickling it down to those who truly deserve it, right? You look at today, interestingly, that amongst the richest people in the world, especially in the black market, are presidents and leaders of third world countries. You're like, why? Hey, look at your own country, how much need there is in those countries, but the selfishness, the greed is there. You look at inequalities in healthcare, right? When COVID hit, we were getting third doses. People in third world countries didn't even have the first dose yet, right? There was an inequality there that existed that made them seem like those lives were less important. And so these inequalities will not change unless we change them. You understand, right? And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear in the Quran. In Surah 13, verse number 11, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, right? That Allah will not change the state of the community or the state of the people unless they change it themselves. And so, even in a very small form, if I want equality, I can be more generous. Now, whether that generosity will trickle down to the world, no, I don't think we can, individual can solve the world's problems as such. But at least I can go to bed saying to God, I tried my best, right? Now, whether somebody else does that and it continues, that's the idea, right? So when you look at these societal inequalities that we see, we're not talking about those because we can't blame that to Allah. Those are not ma faddalallahu bi ba'dihim 'alal ba'd. This is not the advantages that God gives some over others. We're talking about innate factors, right? Innate advantages. Many of the advantages that we see in our world today are because of innate abilities. Innate, you understand, right? Like we are born with this, we are driven by this, we desire to this, we incline towards these as individuals. A lot of these advantages that we see in our world today are because of these innate advantages that people are inclined towards, right? In other words, right, like if, even if we were to create a world, like hypothetically here, naturally, right? Or inshallah, when the imam comes, that if we were to create a world with pure and complete social equality, there would still be advantages that some would have over others, right? Because Allah has created us innately with different desires, with different ambitions, with different goals. We all strive based on what our interests are, right? So certain people, for example, will be inclined towards science. Other people will be inclined towards numbers. Other people may be inclined towards business. Other people may be inclined towards arts. Other people may be inclined towards sports. We're all inclined towards different things. Even in one's own household, you have children who are in different paths, different places. Why? Because innately, they have certain passions that they are driven by, right? And so they are inclining towards that. And these are gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala innately creates human beings with, right? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects is that each individual finds what they are driven towards and then handles that which they are driving towards. And they fulfill or take advantage of what they are naturally inclining towards. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. You understand what we're saying? Right? It's really important because we're coming to the punchline and you need to be with me, right? These internal or innate factors are God-driven, right? And it's not something that we are, we necessarily have a choice in. Now, we have a choice on whether or not we follow through with our innate desires or our innate factors or advantages. But if each individual did, I think one of the outcomes that would come from that would be that it would create a more societally balanced world that we live in. If everyone drove through and worked on those advantages that God has given each individual, right? But if we just look at it from the perspective of understanding, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has innately given us factors or we can call them advantages. God calls them advantages, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given each one of us innate factors that make us do certain things. Like I said, some are inclined towards different things. Now the question that comes about that is that, isn't that still a form of favoritism from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Right? Like, He has given somebody to become a doctor. He's given somebody to become an engineer. Now isn't that a favoritism that God has played? Well, we have to understand this from two perspectives, okay? The first perspective is that society, right? Society is like a body, yeah? It's like a body. And for the body to function cohesively, every part of that body needs to function at its highest level, right? If, for example, we were given all thumbs, we wouldn't be able to do anything, right? We wouldn't be able to function the way that we function. If, for example, every organ acted like the liver, we wouldn't survive, right? But every organ has to work a certain way for that body to be successful. We don't say that the heart is oppressed because it can't work like the liver. No, we don't make that kind of comparison, right? And similarly, when it comes to the world that we live in, likewise in society, we need all of these parts that are there for society to function cohesively, for society to function at its highest form. And this understanding or this knowledge of what society needs for it to successfully work, it comes from what's known as al-hikmatu rabbaniya. It comes from the divine wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah knows that we need doctors to survive, we need engineers to survive, we need people who are veterinarians to survive, we need all of these different organisms, really, for society to thrive. And hence, He has given these advantages to people, not so that they will necessarily be put in different pedestals and different statuses, but so that society will work effectively. Hence, God is saying, don't covet what each other has. Handle what I've given you, is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. You understand? Right? Now, the second question that comes from that as well, which I think is really important, is that, but there are certain advantages that certain professions have, isn't it? Right? like an athlete will be put on a pedestal, right? A doctor will be looked at differently, right? Maulanas will be allowed to cut in line during weddings, right? That's the greatest, that's the only advantage we have, I'm telling you, yeah? But I accept it, alhamdulillah, right? These are advantages that we have, right? Now, these are not advantages that God has placed in there. These are different elevations that we as human beings have done. This is not what Allah has done. Allah didn't tell us to put doctors in the pedestal, right? Allah didn't tell us to put athletes as the highest paid employers of the world or employees of the world. No, Allah didn't do any of these things, right? In the eyes of Allah, every one of these different fields is necessary for society to function correctly. And if we do so, and we honor what God has saying, and we tap into our own advantages, whatever it may be, then I can go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, thank you for allowing me to be what I could be. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. It's an interesting verse, but I hope that I have tried my best to explain it, to give us an understanding of what it means. Yeah, and these advantages that God has given is really in the eye of the beholder, if you think about it, right? That we today think certain things are advantages, but when we look the other way, we look to see that maybe that is an advantage that someone has. And so appreciate our own advantages, our own favors, our own abilities, but there's a responsibility of acting on it. And when we do, inshallah, we will leave this world having fulfilled the resources that God has given us. We end with a few words of Masaib. And today I want to remember the loyal companions of Aba Abdullah alayhi salam. You know, it is said that when Imam alayhi salam gathered his companions on the night of Ashura, he began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Imam says something very beautiful. He says, history has not known companions like you. Subhanallah. You know, we say, Ya laytana kunna ma'akum. Well, I wish we were with you, Ya Aba Abdullah. But those men were given that advantage because Allah knew that they would fulfill that advantage on the day of Karbala. Yeah. Imam says to them that you are free to go. The people who are here are for my blood. They are not here for your blood. The first one to stand up was Abul Fadl al-Abbas. And Abbas says, Mawla, without you, we will not go anywhere. And then the Banu Hashim one by one stood up. The Imam looks at the children of Muslim and he says, your father has given the ultimate gift already by sacrificing his life. You are free to go. They reply back saying that what would we tell our grandmother Fatima on the day of judgment? That we left her son alone on the plains of Karbala, hayhat, we will not do this. And then one by one, the companions stood up. It is said, Muslim ibn Awsaja stands. And Muslim says, Ya Hussein, we will fight them with our swords. And when our swords break, we will pick up rocks and we will throw it at them. And if we were to die 70 times and be brought back to life, this is the end that we would choose. Oh, Hussein. The Imam says, indeed, there are no companions like mine. You know, it is said in traditions that when this declaration was made by each and every one of the companions, it is at this time that Imam al-Hussein tells his companions that look towards the sky. And they looked towards the sky. And Imam said that, oh Habib, that is your place in Jannah. Oh Muslim, that is your place in Jannah. Imam says that it is for this reason that on the day of Karbala, they would run towards swords. They would run towards battle. They had no fear. They had shown their commitment to Hussein. And when the companions left, Imam saw one young boy standing by the door of the tent. The Imam calls him and says, Qasim, do you want to say something? Qasim says, Ya Amma, oh my uncle, will I be amongst those who become shaheed tomorrow? The Imam must have embraced Qasim, seen the shauq of Qasim, seen the desire of Qasim. And he says to him, Ya Qasim, kayfal mawt indak? How do you find death, O Qasim? And he says, Fika ahla min al-asal. With you, O my uncle, death is sweeter than honey. فَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ وَالْعَاقِبَةٌ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the return of our Imam. We ask him to forgive the sins of our parents and loved ones, that for those who are going through difficulty, that he end their difficulty. For those that have asked us to pray for them, Ya Allah, accept their hajat. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'ul alim. Wa tub alayna innaka anta at-tawwabur rahim. Rahimallahu man qara'a suratul mubarakatil fatiha masbuqatan bis-salati ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.